of the diseases, if it does, if it does not get cured, it's going to spread. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, في قلوبهم مرض فزادهم الله مرضا. In their heart there is a disease, and so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increased this disease or made it spread. And this is why we have to hurry to treat our diseases. And if the person take care of himself, nothing will harm him. Nothing, no fitna will harm his pure heart. Now, what are the practical means that would help us to be sincere? The Shaykh said that first is to know Allah. To know Allah, to know the Jannah, whatever it contains of pleasure, whatever it contains of joy for the believers, and to know the hellfire, to know what types of what horrible sins are there in the hereafter, what types of torture that are there in the hellfire, to know the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This type of knowledge drives the person to purify his intention and to become sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It helps him to increase and perfect his sincerity. The second thing is the constant remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make the mention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time. Because if you keep remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will overpower your heart. And if you have a heart that is totally turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this heart is sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third means is to sit with the people of ikhlas, those people who are sincere, because you can learn from them. They can teach you, and this was the practice of the Salaf, that that to have a righteous, knowledgeable companion who is sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you do that, you learn from them, and they will teach you the ikhlas. And finally, the Shaykh mentioned that we need to supplicate to Allah, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us earn this quality and possess this quality. And then he said that we really need to follow the path of the prophets and work very hard in order to possess all these qualities that we have mentioned: the knowledge, the wisdom, the mercy, the humbleness and perseverance and sincerity, in order for us to fulfill the obligations of this trust with which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has entrusted us. And we conclude this part, and inshallah we open, you see, the session for questions and answers, and we'll give inshallah after the mashwara. How many? Because we are late. No question. No.
وكما صار معظمهم أو كثير منهم
نائمون.
توافقون إن شاء الله؟ Or we have 8 minutes if you want to be accurate. طيب. Are you asleep? Okay. They are not asleep. Okay. I have a question. We have 8 minutes and I have a question, because this is something that Sheikh Ahmed Salam mentioned. And it is yani a type of clarification for something. Now, when we are talking about the fact that this da'wah is tawqifiyya, what are we talking about? Are we talking about the means of the da'wah or the methodology of the da'wah? We need to clarify this, inshallah.
Inshallah, I was the one who originally spoke about that issue. But because it's one of those issues that are from the bigger issues in the religion, our dawah and our advice to all of the brothers and the sisters is that I don't care how much knowledge you have, you graduated from Medina or Mecca, or you memorize this from the Quran, or you memorize the 40 hadith of Al-Imam al-Nawawi, it's not important. One of the things we have to understand in our minds and our hearts is that we should leave the dawah up to the ulama of al-Islam and to the people who Allah has blessed them with knowledge. So even though I was the one who spoke about that, and I have an understanding of the concept, because we have people more knowledgeable than me, We're going to allow, inshallah, them to deal with this issue. And hopefully we'll stop with this issue. So we'll leave that to either the Sheikh Muhammad Hassan or the Sheikh Abu Suhaib Ahmed Salam.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين. فيما يتعلق بأمر الدعوة، فلا بد من التفريق بين منهج الدعوة في أصوله وقواعده، فهو أمر توقيفي ليس فيه اجتهاد لأحد من الناس، وإنما هو منهج جاء به رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من عند الله تبارك وتعالى. وإلى هذا يشير قوله تعالى: قل هذه سبيلي أدعو إلى الله على بصيرة أنا ومن اتبعني، إلى آخر الآية. أما وسائل الدعوة فلا شك أن الكثير والكثير جدا من وسائل الدعوة ليس راجعا إلى التوقيف، أي لا يلتزم فيه التزام المسلم بالعبادات التوقيفية. فمثال ذلك، لو اعتبرنا أن وسائل الدعوة توقيفية، معنى ذلك أن المسلم لا يجوز له إلا أن يدعو بنفس الوسائل التي دعا بها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، ولا يغير من ذلك شيئا. وهذا أعتقد أننا متفقون على أنه غير صحيح، بدليل أننا الآن نستخدم وسائل ما كانت في زمن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم، نحن وأنتم كذلك بنفس الحال. فإن هذا أمر الحقيقة أكثر، وما أعلم أن علماء أهل السنة المعاصرين كلهم على أن وسائل الدعوة ليس بتوقيفية، أما منهج الدعوة فهو منهج توقيفي ليس فيه اجتهاد وليس فيه تبديل وليس فيه إلا اتباع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. وهذا ما بلغ إلى علمي، والله سبحانه وتعالى أعلم، وبارك الله تعالى فيكم.
This is a very good clarification, inshallah. And first of all, do we understand the meaning of tawqifi? All of us understand the meaning of tawqifi? No? Okay. Tawqifi is something that is restricted to the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a matter we have no choice but to follow. Now the question is the matter of da'wah tawqifi or not? First, Abu Usama, jazahullahu khayran, he has drawn our attention to this important point that he mentioned, that it is tawqifi. But this is something general. Now, are we talking about the methodology of the da'wah, or are we talking about the means? And here where the clarification is needed. The Sheikh Jazahullahu Khairan clarified, he said, with respect to the methodology of the da'wah, the foundation of the da'wah, the fundamentals of the da'wah, it is tawqifi. In other words, we don't have any choice but to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Now, and this is very clear in the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنْ تَبِعَنِي وَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. Say, this is my way, I call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I and those who follow me, and glory be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I am not among those who ascribe divinity to others beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And other evidences. Now, so with respect to the methodology, it is tawqifi. We don't have any choice. There is no place and room for ijtihad. Now, with respect to the means, the Sheikh said that it is not tawqifi, meaning we can use the halal means in the da'wah, the lawful means in the da'wah. And he said that if this is not true, then we should this means necessarily that we have to follow only the means that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has followed, which is something that all of us here agree that it is not right. And all, he said, I don't know any contemporary scholar who go against this. So with respect to the means, it is more open. It is not a matter, yani here it is more flexible, and we can use all yani the halal, the lawful means in order to call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what time is it now? We are finished.
لقد تكلمت عن الحكمة وأرى أنه من الحكمة ألا نطيل أكثر من ذلك.
He said Sheikh has taught about wisdom, and he say it is of wisdom not to make it longer because it is 11 o'clock. And جزاكم الله خيرا. And we have to be, we have to be fair. I mean, even though I told you to wake up, but I know all of you were waking up with except of one or two. So جزاكم الله خير. بارك الله فيك. سبحانك الله بحمدك. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت استغفرك وأتوب إليك. Please brothers, write down your questions because it's very important. We'll specify a whole.
نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. وبعد. It is with great honor that I sit today in front of you, accompanied with Sheikh Ali Hassan Al-Halabi, who is visiting us at the QSS headquarters building in Warren, Michigan. Insha'Allah, he will be discussing with us موضوع هام, an important topic that is relevant to anyone living in this country of any age group, ألا وهو he will be discussing with us طلب العلم, how to seek knowledge, وأدابه, the manners that we should have, وأصوله, and the principles that we should follow, that we should base it on. And this will be discussed in more than one lecture, في أكثر من لقاء, and it will be over the 2 day program series. فليبدأ مشكورا.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد, فإن مسائل طلب العلم من أهم المسائل التي يجب الاعتناء بضبطها وتأصيلها وتبيين قواعدها وتفصيلها. ذلكم أن المسلم لا يكون مسلما حقا ولا يكون مؤمنا صدقا إلا إذا كان منه التزام بهذا الطلب للعلم ومعرفة له بآدابه وأصوله وقواعده وضوابطه.
The Sheikh حفظه الله began by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending peace and blessings upon his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and stated the question of seeking knowledge is an important question that is relevant to all age groups and as such, because any true believer and anyone who truly believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and wants to implement his belief must be a person that loves and wishes to be from those who are seeking knowledge, wishes to be from those who are implementing the principles, are implementing the adab, the manners, and are striving to be in the character of the way of those who are seeking knowledge in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this question must be addressed, and for this reason the Shaykh will be discussing this important topic with us.
وطالب العلم في طلبه للعلم ينبغي أن يكون كالطائر لا يستطيع الطيران إلا بجناحين أولهما الأدب فيما يتعلمه، والثاني العلم الذي يسعى إليه ليكون من أهله وطلابه إن شاء الله. وقد كان هذا المنهج في سلوك الأدب في الطلب هو منهج الأئمة السابقين، فهو الإمام مهنا. مهنا هو أحد تلاميذ الإمام أحمد رحمه الله، يقول: صحبت أبا عبد الله يعني أحمد بن حنبل فتعلمت منه العلم والأدب، فتعلمت منه العلم والأدب. ولا يتوهمن متوهم أن الأدب شيء مختلف عن العلم، إذ علم بلا أدب كجسد بلا روح، وكذلك أن يدعى أدب بلا علم فإن هذا أيضا كالجسد بلا روح. من أجل ذلك كان يقول هذا الإمام لأصحابه ناقلا لهم عن إمام أهل السنة والجماعة الإمام المبجل أحمد بن حنبل، قال: صحبته فتعلمت منه العلم والأدب. ذلكم أن الأدب هو الوعاء الذي يرتفع به العلم وينتفع به صاحبه.
The chef continued by saying, the student of knowledge must be like a bird, meaning in the way he approaches how he is seeking knowledge. For a bird, for it to rise above the clouds and to gain a high level, it must use its two wings. And the two wings of the student of knowledge are, first, the manners that he must have in seeking it, and second, what is he learning? So these are the two things that you must focus on when you are in the process of seeking knowledge. And he gives us this example by saying the Imam Muhanna, who was one of the students of an Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahumullah, he says, and it is an important statement for us to understand, Sahibtu, I was in the companionship of an Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal for some period of time, and I learned from him. What did he learn? I learned from him knowledge and his manners. I took from his knowledge and I took from his character and manners and how he dealt with people. The chef gives us an important analogy by saying, knowledge without manners is like a body without a soul. Knowledge without manners is like a body without a soul. And manners without knowledge is also like a body without a soul. You cannot exist, you cannot have manners or character without having knowledge. And you cannot have true knowledge without having a refined, perfected character and manner of conduct with people. And this is why when this Imam Muhanna, he says, I was with Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, I learned with him knowledge, from him knowledge and manners. And this, the Shaykh points out, this manner, these manners that you learn are what elevates you above the rest. This is what truly pushes you as a true student of knowledge above the rest.
وقد كان هذا السلوك هو منهج الأئمة جميعهم، فهذا عبد الله بن وهب أحد تلاميذ الإمام مالك إمام دار الهجرة يقول: ما نقلنا من أدب مالك أكثر مما تعلمنا من علمه، إشارة إلى أنه كان يعطيهم العلم ويعطيهم الأدب، كان يجعل أدب العلم أصلا كما يجعل تعليم العلم بنفسه أصلا مساويا له ومواجيا له. وبالتالي فإن نفوس أولئك الأصحاب لهؤلاء الأئمة كانت عالية، وكانت قلوبهم مستوعبة لما يلقى إليها من علم وفهم، وكانت متجاوبة مع ما تسمع من حكم الله وحكم رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. بل إن الإمام مالكا نفسه رحمه الله تعالى كان يقول لأصحابه ولمن يتعلمون العلم عنده: تعلم الأدب قبل أن تتعلم العلم، تعلم الأدب قبل أن تتعلم العلم، لأن من تعلم الأدب يكون مستجيبا لما يلقى إليه، ويكون متواضعا لمن يعلمه، ويكون متجاوبا مع الهدي والنور أو الهدى والنور الذي يلقى إليه من كتاب الله وسنة نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم. ويقول بعض أهل العلم اسمه يوسف ابن الحسين قال: بالأدب تفهم العلم، بالأدب تفهم العلم. ذلكم أن العلم إن لم يكن له أدب قد يجمع بصاحبه ويبعده عن جادة الحق وعن قاعدة الصواب، وينهى به عن أساس الهدى الذي يجب أن يكون العبد سالكا فيه بقوة وثبات وإيمان واطمئنان. وهذه أيها الأخوة في الله، هذه المعاني كلها هي ما أشار إليها النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وآله وسلم بقوله: خصلتان لا تجتمعان في منافق، حسن سمت وفقه في دين، حسن سمت وفقه في دين. فالسمت الحسن ها هنا هو الأدب والتأدب والتخلق بالأخلاق الفاضلة ظاهرا وباطنا، والفقه في الدين هو الوعي عن الله ورسوله كلامهما ومرادهما ومقاصدهما، حتى يكون العبد مؤمنا حق الإيمان بعيدا عن مواقع الظلم والعصيان، متجنبا سبل الفاسقين، ومبتعدا عن طرق المنافقين.
The Sheikh continues by saying, this was not just the way of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal and his students, but it was the way of all of those of the scholars who have come before us in the past, who are upon the correct manhaj, who were from our teachers and our scholars. He says, Abdullah ibn Wahb, one of the students of Imam Malik, rahimahullah, he gives the statement where he says, we never narrated to you, or we never learned something from an Imam Malik. We didn't acquire any knowledge from him, except that we could see it being implemented by him, that it was taught to us in a way, not just by his words, but also by his actions. And this is why the Sheikh, rahimahullah, and Imam Malik, this is why he had such a powerful hold over his students, because they could actually learn from him, from his words and from his actions. The students, as the Sheikh points out, used to love their teacher. And in this love of him, because of his good character and conduct and knowledge, they would gain enormous amounts of knowledge. Not just by his words, but by his actions and the love that was gained for him. And this allowed an increase in learning, and allowed an increase in respecting the Sheikh and learning from him and increasing oneself in knowledge. This is why Imam Malik himself, rahimahullah, he says, learn the manners and the character before you learn and try to acquire the knowledge. Have the character, learn about the suluk, learn about the manners, before you attempt to learn about the specific sciences and the specific knowledge. So as the chef points out to us, for manner, it is the easiest way to gain the trust of your teacher. And it is the easiest way to put your student at ease for him to learn from you. And it is the easiest way to teach others because of your easy and good character and manners that people can feel and receive from you. Yusuf ibn al-Husayn is quoted to have said, with manners you will truly understand the knowledge. When you acquire the manners and character, then you will truly begin to understand that which you may know. Or else, as the Sheikh explains to us, you will be pulled away from the true understanding. You will be pulled away from the verified truth because your character and your actions do not wish to acquire the true understanding of what you may be memorizing and learning. And these statements that we have narrated to you, the Sheikh points out, they have all come together pointing to the statement of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he says two characters that can never be gathered in a munafiq, in a hypocrite. From them, husnu qamtin, that a person has this way of dealing with people, and the Sheikh points out, meaning that he has good manners and a good character. وَفِقْهُ فِي الدِّينِ, and he has a good understanding of the religion, meaning that the person understands the purpose of what he's being taught, of what the Rasul meant, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's understanding how to implement it, how it can be used practically. All of it, this is the fiqh of the religion. So these are the two characteristics that you will never find in a person who is a hypocrite. A person who has good manners, and he also has a vast knowledge of Islam, not just the words, but how to implement it and practice it and their purpose. And with this, a person will be able to be led away from oppression and brought closer to the goodness and the light of Islam, and to not be from those who oppress or from those who are doing the oppression.
أما أيها الأخوة بالله, أهم آداب طلب العلم, بل أهم قواعده, بل أهم ما يقوم عليه الطلب كله, هو إخلاص العمل لله عز وجل. أن تكون أيها الأخ المؤمن مريدا في علمك وتعلمك وجه الله. وإذا كان العلم هو أساس الأعمال, فإن ما يبنى عليه الأساس يكون آخذا, أو ما يبنى على الأساس يكون آخذا حكمه سواء بسواء. فإذا قلنا بلزوم وجوب الإخلاص لله في العلم, فإن هذا الوجوب واللزوم ينبغي أن يسترسل مع كل عمل ينشأ على هذا العلم في كل ما تقوم به أيها المسلم في حياتك جميعها وفي شؤونك كلها, كما قال الله عز وجل, وما أمروا إلا ليعبدوا الله مخلصين له الدين حنفاء ويقيموا الصلاة إلى آخر الآية. وقال سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه العزيز, ومن أحسن دينا ممن أسلم وجهه لله وهو محسن واتبع ملة إبراهيم حنيفا. فإحسان الدين لله تبارك وتعالى لا يكون إلا بإخلاصه لله عز وجل والصدق مع الله سبحانه وتعالى. وفي الحديث المتفق على صحته عن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, إنما الأعمال بالنيات, وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى, فمن كانت هجرته إلى دنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هجر إليه، ومن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله. وفي حديث أبي هريرة أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إن أول الناس يقضى يوم القيامة عليه أن يحاكم ويبين فعله سدادا واستقامة بعدا واجتنابا هم ثلاثة نفر: الشهيد والعالم والمتصدق، فيسأل الله عز وجل كلا منهم وهو أعلم به فيما فعلت كذا وكذا، فيقول: يا رب في سبيلك وابتغاء مرضاتك، فيقول: كذبت، بل فعلت ذلك ليقال شهيد او ليقال جواد او ليقال عالم، وقد قيل: ألقوه في النار فيلقى او فيؤمر به فيسحب على وجهه حتى يلقى في النار. هذه نصوص تؤكد ذلك اللزوم وتوجب ذلك الحق الذي يجب ان يكون مطمئنا به قلب كل طالب علم يريد في علمه وتعلمه وجه الله والدار الاخره. وها هنا كلمة جميلة للإمام أبي عبد الله شمس الدين الذهبي رحمه الله تعالى، يقول فيها: قد يكون طلب العلم الذي هو الواجب والمستحب المتأكد مذموما في حق بعض الرجال. كيف يكون مذموما طلب العلم وهو من الأمور التي ينال بها صاحبها الدرجات العالية ويستحق من خلال طلبه الثواب الكبير من ربه العلي القدير؟ قال: كمن يطلب العلم ليجاري به العلماء، أي ليقال عنه عالم أو من أهل العلم ويماري به السفهاء،
يجادلهم بغير حق وينقض سفههم وليصرف به الأعين إليه،
او ليعظم ويقدم، كأن يقال له وبه: هذا عالم، او لتجتمع عليه العيون وترفع الأيدي امامه. قال: وينال من الدنيا المال والجاه والرفعة، فهذا ايضا احد الثلاثة الذين تسعر بهم النار، كما ورد في ذلك الحديث عن سيد الابرار صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه اجمعين.
Now let us focus on the point. He says, by far the most important point and principle and manner altogether for the person who wants to seek knowledge and learn about this deen and religion, the first and most important point, foundation, is al-ikhlas, sincerity. You must seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Him and only Him, seeking the faith of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your worship and also in your intention of seeking knowledge. And this is the foundation that you will build onto all that you will learn later on. So the foundation must be the sincerity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. They were only asked, all that they were ordered to do was worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with sincerity in their religion to Him, in their actions to Him, till the end of the ayah. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and who is better in religion? Who is better in his worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the one who submits his faith to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's order in sincerity and follows the millah, the way of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And this all comes to the hadith narrated by Umar ibn al-Khattab, which is agreed upon, that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إنما الأعمال بالنيات, verily all actions are judged in accordance to the intentions they were performed with. So if you had made the hijrah for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger, then this is the reward that you will receive, because you have done it for Allah's pleasure. But if you have done your hijrah for another reason, for wealth or marriage, then this will be the reward that you will be given. And also the famous hadith which is narrated by Abu Hurairah, which is in Sahih Muslim, where the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the first people or the first types of people that will be judged on the day of judgment are three: the shaheed, the martyr, who died fighting in the cause of Allah, and the scholar, and the one who is giving always in charity. And the hadith is long, and the Shaykh summarized it for us, which states the first of one, the shaheed, will be brought, and Allah will show him the mercy that He bestowed to him by giving him the ability to fight in His cause. And Allah will ask him, what did you do with this gift we gave to you? And he will say, I fought in your cause, O Allah, until I met my martyrdom. And Allah shall answer him and say, kadhabt, no, you are a liar. For you fought so that people will say, you are courageous. And it was said to you, faqad qeel, it was told to you. And then it will be ordered, and you will be taken and thrown in the fire. Then the second, the scholar, shall be brought. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell him and show him the mercy of knowing about Islam, knowing the knowledge, after having learned and memorized. And Allah will tell him, what did you do with this gift we bestowed to you? And he will say, I learned and then I taught people for your sake, O Allah. Allah shall tell him, kadhabt, you are a liar. It's there you learned so that people will say, MashaAllah, he is a alim. So that people will say, he is a scholar. And then he will be ordered and he will be thrown in the fire. And the same shall be done for the person who gives in charity, for he is a person who in fact he's to give, so that people will say, MashaAllah, he is very open in giving from his wealth, not for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they shall be admitted to the fire for the sins that they have committed in not placing their sincerity only in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Shaykh concludes by saying, Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, Shamsuddin, he gives us a beautiful statement by saying, seeking knowledge may be an affliction or an evil point to a human, to a certain type of person. After having just stated that knowledge is a beautiful thing, all of us must strive to learn about Islam, Al-Imam al-Dhahabi says, but for some people, it can be an evil or an affliction upon them. And the Shaykh asks, how can this be? And then Imam al-Dhahabi, he answers by saying, because for some people, they will want to be called a scholar, so this is why they learn. Others, they want to be able to sit in front of ignorant people and seem like they are higher than them, argue with them, tell them, no, you haven't read this, this is what it is. Others, they are seeking it so that the eyes may be turned to them, looking at them, oh, he is such and such and such. Others, they may seek knowledge only so that they may be given a position for wealth. So these are things, although seeking knowledge in itself is a blessed thing, but for such a type of person who falls into these categories, which are listed in the hadith of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in different ahadith, all of them, the one who wants people to look at him, the one who wants to seem like a scholar, all of these things will make him, in being a student of knowledge, an affliction and an evil upon him, instead of being a blessed thing. And this is where the Shaykh had stopped.
ومما ينبغي أن يكون قاعدة ينطلق منها ويصدر عنها طالب العلم في طلبه استحضار تقوى الله في سائر شؤونه وحالاته. والله عز وجل يقول في كتابه العزيز: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وآمنوا برسوله يؤتكم كفلين من رحمته ويجعل لكم نورا تمشون به. فالرحمة هي الاستعداد للعلم، والنور هو نور العلم الذي يسدد الله عز وجل به عباده على طريق طاعته سبحانه في علاه. وأيضا يقول رب العالمين: يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن تتقوا الله يجعل لكم فرقانا. والفرقان كما قال الإمام محمد بن إسحاق فيما نقله عنه الإمام ابن كثير في تفسيره، هو الفيصل بين الحق والباطل. فكيف يستطيع عبد أن يفرق بين الحق والباطل وأن يعرف الحق باتباعه وامتثاله وأن يعلم الباطل باجتنابه والحذر منه والتحذير عنه إن لم يكن عنده علم يسدده وتقوى تؤيده؟ ولذلك كان السلف رضي الله تعالى عنهم من الصحابة والتابعين يتنبهون إلى هذا المعنى جيدا، ويعلمون أن هنالك توافقا كبيرا وجودا وانتفاء بين العلم والتقوى. فهو ذا عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه يقول: إني لأحسب أن الرجل ينسى العلم كان يعلمه بالخطيئة يعملها، فجعل الخطيئة التي يرتكبها طالب العلم سببا ينسيه علمه الذي تعلمه وفهمه الذي أراد أن يسلك به في سبيله ودربه. وقال الإمام وكيع بن الجراح الرؤاسي: استعينوا على الحفظ بترك المعاصي، استعينوا على الحفظ بترك المعاصي. وهنا كلمة مشهورة في الكتب على اختلاف في إثباتها ونفيها، وإن كان الراجح عندي إثباتها، وهي كلمة الإمام الشافعي حيث يقول: شكوت إلى وكيع سوء حفظي فأرشدني إلى ترك المعاصي وأخبرني بأن العلم نور ونور الله لا يؤتى بعاصي. وها هنا تأكيد لهذا المعنى مما نقله ابن القيم رحمه الله في كتابه إعلام الموقعين، أن وكيعا أو أن الإمام مالكا عندما لقي الشافعي قال له، الإمام مالك هو شيخ الشافعي، قال له: إني أرى الله قد ألقى على قلبك نورا فلا تطفئه بظلم المعصية. ألا وهو نور العلم وظلم المعصية التي يخالف بها صاحبها أمر الله، فيتنكب العلم الذي تعلمه أمرا وانتهاء استجابة وتركا.
The Sheikh Hafizahullah continues with the second point: after ikhlas, it is important for each and every one of us, and those especially who are in the state of seeking knowledge, to establish taqwa Allah Azza wa Jal, the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but not just in the actions related to seeking knowledge, to establish taqwa Allah in all of your actions, in everything that you do. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, O ye who believe, fear Allah and believe in His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in so doing you will be given twice the reward from Allah and twice the mercy, and you will be rewarded by the light that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall bestow to you. And the Shaykh gives us the understanding that this light is the light of knowledge, being able to distinguish the good from the evil. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in another verse in the Quran, in Surah Al-Furqan, in Surah Al-Anfal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا O ye who believe, if you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will grant you the Furqan, a criterion to judge between what is right and what is wrong. And this is what Imam Ibn Kathir has said is the best translation for the word, or the best understanding for the word Furqan, that you will be able to judge between what is halal, what is haram, what is good, what is bad, what is right and what is wrong. And this is something that the Salaf al-Salih, and especially the Sahaba and the Tabi'een, all of them knew quite well, the direct link that is established between knowledge and the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the consciousness of Allah, taqwallah, Azza wa Jal. For we hear the statement of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu wa ardah, where he says that the direct reason, al-khati'a, is the main reason that a person may forget that which he already knew and memorized from the past. He says, you will see a person who you may think has forgotten, or who you will know has forgotten what he used to know, and it's directly, the direct reason is because of his sin that he may be on now or has abandoned from before. Also, Waqi'a, one of the scholars from the past, he says, in order to be able to memorize, you must have the ability to stop sinning. If you want to memorize, if you want to learn, if you want to seek knowledge, you must not be a sinner. You must stay away from the khati'ah. And this is something that is, the Shaykh points out to us, the poem that Imam Shafi'i, and as the Shaykh says, there is some debate as to the authenticity, but the Shaykh Hafizahullah, he says, inshallah, it is an established narration, in his opinion, where the Imam Shafi'i, he says, I complained in verses of poetry, I complained to my friend about the ability of memorizing and about wanting to learn, about my weak memory. So he told me, فَأَرْشَدَنِي بِتَرْكِ الْمَعَاصِي. He ordered me and he told me, stop sinning and you shall learn. For the nur of Allah, the light of Allah, as we told you, it is knowledge that is bestowed to a person. لَا يُعْطَى لِعَاصِي. It is not given to a person. It is not given to a person who sins. And this is also established from the statement of an Imam Malik, when he first saw a Shafi'i who recited to him from memory, or who saw a Shafi'i and he saw him, that he had this way of knowing things, of learning, a light that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon a Shafi'i, who would eventually be Imam Malik's student, and he told him, Ya Shafi'i, do not allow yourself to fall into sin, for the sin shall cause you to lose this great gift that Allah has bestowed you, this memory. It will allow you, do not extinguish the light that Allah has bestowed to you by sinning, for therefore you will not have this ability that you may have now. And these are the words, and this narration is from Imam Ibn al-Qayyim's work. And this is where the Shaykh has gone.
وأيضا هنالك كلمتان في هذا المقام عن أولاهما عن الإمام الشافعي، حيث يقول رحمه الله: من أحب أن يفتح الله له قلبه وينوره فعليه بترك الكلام فيما لا يعنيه، رحمك الله، وترك الذنوب واجتناب المعاصي، ويكون له فيما بينه وبين الله خبيئة من عمل، شيء لا يعلم به إلا الله، عمل صالح يكون بين العبد وربه، كصدقة السر أو شيء مثلها. قال فإنه إذا فعل ذلك فتح الله عليه من العلم ما يشغله عن غيره من غير طلب العلم والأعمال الصالحة. قال وإن في الموت لأكثر الشغل، أي إن الموت هو السبيل الذي يجب أن يكون عمل العاملين وشغل المشتغلين متوجها إليه، لأنه الصفحة المطوية التي لا يعلم أحد متى تأتيه وكيف تأتيه وهل عنده من العلم أو العمل ما عند ربه ينجيه، هذا يجعل الموت كما قال الشافعي رحمه الله إن في الموت لأكثر الشغل. ويقول شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله تعالى والله سبحانه جعل مما يعاقب به الناس على الذنوب سلب الهدى والعلم النافع عنه، فهذا السلب مما هو عقوبة من الله لبعض من تلبس بمخالفة أمر الله من معصية أو فسق أو كبيرة أو كفر. ثم قال شيخ الإسلام كقوله تعالى وقالوا قلوبنا غلف بل طبع الله عليها بكفرهم، فإذ قد كفروا طبع الله على قلوبهم حتى لا تستجيب للهدى لأنهم زاغوا فأزاغ الله قلوبهم. قال وقال أيضا أي رب العالمين وما يشعركم أنها إذا جاءت لا يؤمنون ونقلب أفئدتهم وأبصارهم كما لم يؤمنوا به أول مرة، فهم لم يؤمنوا بالله عز وجل في أول شأنهم وكذلك لا يؤمنون به في آخر شأنهم، لأن قلوبهم مطبوع عليها بالران والغلف وما يحجب عنها الهدى والحق، كما قال الله عز وجل أيضا في قلوبهم مرض فزادهم الله مرضا، وكما قال فلما زاغوا أزاغ الله قلوبهم، وكما قال نسوا الله فأنساهم أنفسهم، وكما قال نسوا الله فنسيهم، هذا كله بمقابل الزيغ والانحراف الذي يعاقب عليه صاحبه بمثله وما يشبهه. أما إذا كان ذا طاعة واستقامة فالأمر فيه كما قال الله عز وجل إنهم فتية آمنوا بربهم فزدناهم هدى، فالتقوى باب يجلب الخير ويقربه، وبعدها والابتعاد عنها يدفع الخير ويجلب بدلا منه الشر والضر والضير. هذه نقطة أولى في هذا المقام. وأما النقطة الثانية وهي التي نختم بها هذه النقطة فهي أن كثيرا من الناس يتوهم أن التقوى وحدها سبيل لتحصيل العلم، ويستدل على ذلك بقوله تعالى واتقوا الله ويعلمكم الله، وهذا ما بين فساد الاستدلال به الإمام ابن القيم ذاكرا أن قوله واتقوا الله جملة لا تعلق لها بقوله ويعلمكم الله، بل هما جملتان مستأنفتان مستقلتان لا صلة للأولى بالآخرة، ويدل على هذا المعنى قوله سبحانه في علاه في الآية التي ذكرناها: إن تتقوا الله يجعل لكم فرقانا. فلو كان الأمر مرتبا به حكم على حكم لقال واتقوا الله يعلمكم الله، لكنه لم يقل ذلك، وإنما قال واتقوا الله ثم ذكر جملة أخرى وحكما آخر، قال ويعلمكم الله سبحانه وتعالى. ويدل على هذا المعنى الصحيح السديد قول النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم: إنما العلم بالتعلم، والفقه بالتفقه، والحلم بالتحلم، ومن يتحرى الخير يؤتى، ومن يتوقى الشر يوقى. فلا يجوز أن يرد على ذهن أحد منا جميعا أن يجلس ويقول أنا أتقي الله وسيتنزل علي علم ناشئ عن هذه التقوى، هذا ليس من الحق ولا قريبا منه ولا ذا صلة به في قليل أو كثير.
The Sheikh, continuing with the point about taqwa Allah Azza wa Jal, he states two words or two different statements that we wish for you to understand. First, let us look at Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, where he says, whoever loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or whoever wants Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open his heart so that he may accept and learn and seek knowledge, let him do these following things. First, let him not talk. Let him not talk in that which he has no right in speaking about. Something that you are not versed in, do not speak in it. Something that does not concern you, stay away from it. He says, and to not be in sin openly and in secret. And the Imam Shafi'i continues and says, and to perform good deeds or deeds hidden. As the Sheikh pointed out, he gives us the example of giving sadaqah without anyone knowing, so that this action will be forever linked just with you subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no one else knows this good deed that you have done, giving you and helping you in the field of ikhlas and sincerity. And the Sheikh says, and know that for death is the greatest concern. Your whole concern in life is how you will meet Allah. This is what you should be concerned with. This is what your focus should be. How you will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the Sheikh says, you do not know when your final page in life will be turned. You do not know whether you will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with good enough deeds to enter the Jannah. You do not know if you have done enough in pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second statement that... giving them knowledge, and by not giving them the truth in guidance. This is a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is due to their own sins, that this knowledge is withheld from them and the huda is kept away. For as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in describing the Jews, they say, وَقَالُوا قُلُوبُنَا غُلْفٌ. They say, our hearts are full of غُلْف. Verily, مَنْ لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهُ verily, خَتَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ. Verily, it is Allah who has stamped their hearts because of their disbelief. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was also the reason for them in not accepting the guidance. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, نَسُوا اللَّهُ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنْفُسَهُمْ. They forgot Allah, they forgot the orders that Allah gave them, so Allah caused them to forget their own self. Also in another ayah, نَسُوا اللَّهُ فَنَسِيَهُمْ. They forgot Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so Allah forgot them, meaning abandoned them, left them to do what they wanted, without guidance and without knowledge. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the other example of those who remember Allah. Allah increases them in belief, increases them in iman, as what happened with Ashabul Kahf, the young youth who hid in the cave. وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَىٰ. We increased them in guidance because they removed themselves from the evil, seeking only the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Shaykh says the second point that he wishes to make for us is that many people falsely believe, and I repeat, falsely believe, that just because you fear Allah, that means somehow miraculously you're going to learn about Islam. And this is false. Not because you are fearing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that that's it. You're going to learn about Islam eventually. You're going to seek knowledge in this way. No. The Shaykh says, and they use the ayah proving إِن تَتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ no, the verse in Surah Al-Baqarah. If you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or when they fear Allah, Allah shall give them knowledge. And the way that it is recited, as Shaykh al-Islam ibn al-Qayyim points out, they do not understand the way it is in the Arabic language. Meaning that the ayah, the true understanding is, fear Allah, and it's the end of the sentence. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and also Allah shall teach you. But this does not mean because you fear Allah, therefore right away you are going to learn about Islam. For if Allah had meant this meaning, that if you fear Allah and that is it, you will learn about Islam, Allah would have said in the Quran, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ, and Allah then for sure will teach you. The example in the Arabic language, the way it is translated, fear Allah, stop. Allah will teach you. The way if it was that Allah had meant that because you fear Allah you would automatically learn, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have said, fear Allah and you will surely be given knowledge. And this is not the way the ayah is recited or meant in the Arabic language. And also, the statement of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, verily, understanding of this religion can only be acquired by seeking it. And al-ilm.